What's up, y'all? Welcome back to the Cat and Cloud YouTube channel. It's me, Alex, and I've got Mark here today. Mark works with me in wholesale, and he was the dude who came with me to Kenya a couple months ago.
Really, really amazing trip. One of the things that was most striking to us was just how complicated the Kenyan coffee system is. So this video is gonna be all about breaking that down.
Yeah, it is really complex, and that's why we asked Christoph, who organized the trip for us, to come in for an interview and just talk about it some more. He can definitely explain it a lot better than I can. So Christoph, to start things off, will you just introduce yourself real quick and just tell us, you know, who you are, what you do?
Yeah, so I'm Christoph. I'm 22 years old. I live in Nairobi, Kenya. I work for the Norman Coffee Group here in Kenya, and we export coffees from Kenya and Tanzania. I'm a trader here. I love my job. I love tasting all the different coffees. I love traveling through Kenya, Tanzania, working with different people and discovering new coffees.
Okay, Christoph, will you just give me like a broad strokes overview of the Kenyan coffee system?
So let's begin with the production. So around 70% of the volume produced in Kenya is produced by smallholders. And smallholders, by definition, is any coffee grower which has less than 5 acres of planted coffee. And by law, this smallholder has then to deliver to a nearby cooperative or washing station to let his coffee being processed. And the remaining 30% of the production are being produced by mostly big, but there are also a few smaller farms. I would say today, 5 to 10% of the Kenyan coffee production is exported as specialty coffee. The remaining is more commercial grades. However, I would say that specialty in Kenya is a little bit different than other origins. Most of the coffee is already from very high quality, but those 5 to 10% are only referring to, let's say, the micro-lot business. Kenyan coffee production, as I think most of the people know, has really dropped in the last 20, 25 years. And Kenya is still producing between, let's say, 650 and 900,000 bags every year. And it's important also that Kenya at least holds to this volume, so that many buyers will still keep buying Kenyan coffee. Also, what's very unique to Kenya is, of course, the taste profile. It's I would say, a taste profile that you would not find somewhere else in another country. We just have like 4 varieties in Kenya. So the 2SL, the Ruiru, and the Batian. It's also what is like very special to Kenya, that we just grow those varieties.
One thing that came up while we were there was just how the government is involved in the coffee system. So if you could tell us more about that.
So I guess the Kenya coffee system as it is today is one of the most regulated markets. It is very clear who has to do what and who can do what. For us, it's a very transparent system because the Nairobi Coffee Exchange, where everyone gets the samples 1 week before the auction, everyone can taste the coffees, and at the end everyone has the possibility to bid on the coffees. If you would want to buy coffee at the Kenya or the Nairobi Coffee Exchange, you would have to have a dealer's license. A lot of rules and regulations have just been taken over after the independence of Kenya, but at least it's a way for them to really structure the coffee business in Kenya.
Okay, so a lot of terminology seems to get thrown around about the different players in the Kenyan coffee system. So can you explain the difference to me between farms, washing stations, and co-ops?
Every coffee grower in Kenya has a coffee farm, but you can only process your coffee yourself as a farm if you have more than 5 acres of planted coffee. If you have less, you have to deliver to the nearby washing station. Different washing stations are regrouped and belong to one cooperative. This cooperative is managing the different washing stations, processing the coffee, drying the coffee, and bringing the coffee to the dry mills. Yeah, what's happening is that the cooperative is owned by the farmers, by the members. So after the coffee is sold, what's deducted is just the overheads of the cooperative. It is not allowed to be more than 20%. Then those 80% or more are being paid to the farmers. You know, most of the farmers have to borrow money from the cooperative for different things, for example, school loans, fertilizers, if they need to hire a picker for the season. The cooperative will lend the money to the farmer, and then Once it comes to the payout, the cooperative will deduct whatever has been borrowed and then pay out the rest of the difference.
So one thing that I knew nothing about going to Kenya was the marketing agency system and how that relates to factories and co-ops. Could you tell us a little bit more about that, Christoph?
So basically, the marketing agency is representing any grower. So this might be an estate or the washing station at the Nairobi Coffee Exchange and selling coffee on their behalf. Each washing station has the right to choose the marketing agency. So for example, in the cooperative A, there might be 6 washing stations and 3 of them would choose Tropical Farm Management and maybe 3 of them would choose another one. It's really up to them. Tropical Farm Management today is one of the marketing agencies in Kenya. For example, we are organizing farmer trainings. At the different time of the year, you have to teach different topics. You have to train pruning, how to use fertilizers responsibly. And then as Tropical Farm Management also, we are pre-financing cooperatives. We are also marketing the coffee of a lot of producers.
Okay, so there's marketing agencies, but then what is a dealer or a trader and how does that work?
Tropical Farm Management is selling on behalf of the farmer, and Ibero Kenya is where I work is it's a dealer or it's an exporter in the auction. So we are sitting at the auction and buying coffees from different producers, different marketing agencies.
Can you tell us more about what the second window is?
Once the cooperatives or the washing stations have milled their coffee, sometimes it takes a long time, a few weeks at least, to bring the coffee to the auction because also there's limited slots for each marketing agency, depending on how much market share you have. The dealers then can make offers to the different co-ops or washing stations for different lots. If the grower agrees to sell the coffee at this price, it's possible then to buy the coffee. It represents for the grower a possibility to be paid out faster, you know?
Christoph's here right now, by the way.
Yeah, he's just on the other side of this. He flew out from Kenya to come for our interview.
So one of the things we noticed when we were there was just how limited traceability is in Kenya. So can you tell me more about some of the challenges involved in traceability?
So for example, of course, the farmers will deliver the ripe cherries at the washing station. It is very difficult or almost impossible for farmers to know, okay, which lot where I contributed is sold at which auction, you know? Let's say the traceability is only being traced back at the moment to the washing station level, where we say, okay, this is this day's production from this washing station.
One thing that we talked about when we were there was just the fluctuation of the Kenyan coffee market. So what do you think are some of the biggest challenges for the Kenyan coffee growers?
I would say there are different factors who are contributing to this. Of course, yeah, the real estate price, as it is in a lot of places, a lot of young people migrate to the cities to get jobs there, where the, you know, technology is booming in Nairobi. Climate change is a big issue, you know. Now we are in the month of January and it should be very hot and dry normally, but it's still raining and it's we don't know how the next crop will be. So all those factors make the production very, very difficult for any grower in Kenya.
So yeah, how are you addressing these threats in Kenya and what does the future of the Kenyan coffee system look like?
I think the future of Kenyan coffee looks very professional and more digital. A lot of digitalization will also help the growers to understand why some diseases are attacking. I mean, we have already said climate change is, if not the biggest issue at the moment in Kenya. But the problem is you cannot control it, you know. But what you can control, it's the production, you know. Transferring knowledge and teaching coffee farmers how really to grow coffee is a big future in Kenya coffee.
One thing that I've been thinking about is when we were at one of the co-ops, we were served coffee that came out of a tin can that was labeled premium Kenyan coffee, but it was instant coffee and you did 2 scoops with little hot water and then equal amounts of cream. And this just got me wondering like what the coffee scene in Kenya is like in general. Could you speak to that a little bit? What's the scene like?
Kenyan people historically are not coffee drinkers. Most of the Kenyan people drink tea, and I think it's changing in the cities, at least, you know, where there are a lot of people also living more and more Western lifestyle. And in those places, of course, people are drinking, you know, their cappuccino or their latte macchiato. But as students to go up country or outside of Nairobi, you'll not see this.
Just seeing how like complex and crazy the Kenyan coffee system is and knowing that you know, other countries are dealing with a lot of similar problems in the coffee industry. What can coffee roasters do, and also coffee consumers, to better support producers of coffee?
Give the producers an incentive of producing better quality. If you are able to support producers year on year, you know, if you, for example, you want to focus on one cooperative or one factory, that kind of you establish a relationship with those people, and then you come back and say, oh, you know what, last year we found that the coffee didn't taste so great as 2 years ago. And then you start discussing, oh, what might be the reason? And then, because basically they could also benefit and start searching themselves, what can they do better, you know? Yeah, I would always recommend end consumers to question, if possible, or to at least have an interest for the coffee. Where does it come from? How was it produced? Also, I would say to someone who, you know, wants to drink the best cup of coffee, you might pay, I don't know, $7, $8 or $9. If you want to drink the best wine, the best whiskey, it's going to cost you a couple of $1,000s. So coffee actually is a product where a lot of people can afford to drink the best of a certain country, you know?
So we talk a lot about Kenya and the coffee, but Christoph, what's your favorite part of your job? Like, what do you get to do that makes you happy?
Favorite part of my job is, cupping all the different coffees, you know, and also following different producers through different seasons, seeing how the different producers are progressing, and also discovering new coffees, seeing all the different roasters of, like, you know, when you're like, I don't know, 16, 17, you work as a barista, and you look on YouTube and you know how to make cappuccino, and then look on Instagram, follow the big pages, and then you're here, and actually the guys come to visit you, and you have to teach them or show them around the Kenyan coffee. It's like 3-4 years ago, I would never have thought this. Showing people around in Kenya, you know, how incredible Kenya is, how incredible Kenyan coffee is, you know, and then there is actually a big future, in my opinion. So I encourage everyone to visit Kenya, of course. I mean, Kenya is a very diverse country. You know, you can do very nice safaris. You can go up country at the Mount Kenya. You can go to the coast. And if you have the chance to pass by, also you can visit some Kenya coffee producers and understand how much work goes into the coffee that you might be drinking day on day. And I welcome you to visit Kenya. We'll keep in touch. Thanks a lot, Alec. And have a good weekend, huh?
What a cool guy, huh? Can you believe he's only 22 years old? It's insane.
Put me away.
Yeah, thank you so much for Christoph for not only just organizing this trip and for your hospitality and sharing all your knowledge and also being down to do this video. Really appreciate it.
Yeah, I just gotta echo that. Thank you so much, Christoph. Like, you gave us an amazing experience in a country that was very far away and made us feel at home and taken care of, and we really appreciate that. And we also gotta give a thank you to Cat and Cloud for giving us this opportunity to travel halfway around the world. It's just truly amazing, something we're incredibly thankful for.
So yeah, there it is. There's the Kenyan coffee system for you. I hope this video has been entertaining and informative. Do me a favor and comment down below if you've learned something new. Let me know. So yeah, thanks so much for watching, and yeah, I'll see you next time.
Thanks, everybody. Just threw a little damn straight.